In this video, I'll show you how to automate your life with Python by working on three fun, simple, yet effective projects that really illustrate the power of knowing Python and specifically the automation techniques. Now, these three projects will be the following. The first is a currency converter, the next is a YouTube video downloader, and the last one is an automated scheduling software for backing up a directory or a folder or whatever files you want on your computer. These projects should take us just a few minutes to build out. I'm going to explain them line by line, and even if you're a beginner Python programmer, you can follow along. Now, with that said, if you are a beginner Python programmer, you probably want to check out this completely free resource, which is an introduction to Python from our video sponsor, HubSpot. Now, this guide is designed for marketers, developers, data analysts, or really anyone trying to get better at Python. And what it does is break down what Python is, some of the methods and functions, the best practices and coding standards, and goes over advanced Python as well. Now, I've left a link in the description so you can check it out completely for free. Python is a super popular programming language and something you can use in your everyday life, even if you don't want to become a developer. Definitely check out this guide if you want to get better at it and really unlock the power of being able to script in Python. Now, a big shout out to our video sponsor HubSpot for providing this resource and many others completely for free. Again, you can check it out from the link in the description. All right, so let's dive into the first project here, which is going to be a currency converter. This will allow us to convert pretty much any currency to any other currency or to a whole list of currencies. So for example, if you're always interested in the daily exchange rates between maybe US dollar, Canadian dollar, Dirham, Euro, whatever it may be, you can set that up in this program. Simply click one button on your computer and you'll be able to see all of them in front of you. That's how we're going to kind of automate this. Anyways, first thing we need is some kind of code editor. So I have Visual Studio Code open, but you can use anything that you'd like. You just need to be able to edit a Python file. Now, what I'm going to do is make a new Python file. So I'm going to go here to VS Code. I'm going to call this currency.py. Okay, so we've got a Python file open here. Now, what we're going to use for this specific project is something known as an API. Now, an API stands for an application programming interface. This is something that we can call that will return some data to our code. So we're actually going to use a free API that exists on the internet. There are literally millions of APIs that are completely free that can do pretty much anything you want. And once I show you in this video how to access them, you'll be able to use really any API you want and you'll see it's super simple. Now, what we do need to do here though is install a Python module that's going to allow us to actually call this API in a really easy manner. This module is called requests. Some of you may already have it installed, but what you're going to want to do is open up a terminal window. If you're on Mac, Linux, doesn't matter, just open up your terminal or command prompt, and you're going to want to type the following command, which is pip install and then requests. Now, if you're on Mac or Linux, you're going to do pip 3 install requests, hit enter, and that should go ahead and install this module for you. Now, for some reason, this command does not work. I will leave two videos on the screen and linked in the description that will show you how to fix this pip command. Specifically, they go over fixing or installing Pygame. When you get to the step where you're installing Pygame, instead of Pygame, you can just install requests and it should fix it for you. Okay, so now that we have requests installed, just to test our code, we're going to import requests in our Python file. I think it goes without saying at this point, I'm assuming you have Python installed and we can go ahead and run our code. Now, you guys probably know how to run your code. You can do it from the little run button up here in VS Code. But if for some reason that's not working for you, you can go to your terminal and you can type Python and then the name of your Python file, as long as you are in the right directory or the same directory where your Python file exists. So in this case, mine's on the desktop inside of this folder. So I do Python currency.py. If we don't get any errors, we are good to go. If you're on Mac or Linux, you can do Python 3 currency.py and that should work for you. Okay, so now let's load up the API that we're going to be using. Now, I'll link everything in the description, so don't worry about that. But the API we're going to use is the free currency API. Again, you can find any one that you want, but I just went for one that was free and tested it to make sure that it's working. As you can see here, it gives you kind of a demo, so you can pick some different currencies you want to convert between. We can check the rates, and it should just give us the answer, right? So one USD is equal to this much Australian dollar. If I change this to euro, you can see we get the euro rate. Awesome. Now, what you're going to need to do here is go and click on this button that says get 100% free API key. You'll need to make an account. I actually already have one made, so it just brings me to my dashboard. But in your case, you want to make an account. So go ahead, sign up for one. You can obviously unregister from the email list or whatever. And what we're going to be looking for here is this API key. Okay, so it says default key. So we're going to copy that key and we're going to go to our Python file and we're going to make a variable in all capitals called API key like this. And we're going to put a string and we're going to paste the key inside of here. Perfect. Now, the reason I did all capitals is whenever you have a constant value that's not going to change in Python, you typically put it in capitals. Perfect. Now that we have that, we also just want to get what's known as the root for our API, or kind of the domain that we're going to be calling. So what we can do is actually head over here to the request playground, and you'll see that it has a generated request URL. So what I'm going to do is just copy the URL here, and we're going to make another variable called base underscore URL, and we're going to make this equal to a string, and we're going to put this URL inside. Now we're going to clean this up a little bit. I'm just going to remove everything that comes after the API key, and I'm going to kind of explain how this works. So right here, this is our main domain, and then this is the root that we're going to access that will give us the kind of currency information. Now, in order to use this, we have to pass the API key, so we have some kind of authorization. So what we're going to do is use an fstring. An fstring allows us to embed variables inside of curly braces here. So if I put f before my string and then I put my curly braces, I can now put the variable API key, and what I've done is injected my API key into this base URL. And now what we'll do is we'll actually make a function that will utilize this URL to send a request to the API, which will then return some data back to us. So we're going to make a function here called convert underscore currency. Okay. Inside of here, we're going to take a base. Now the base is going to be the base currency or the base currency ticker that we want to convert from. Now, what we're going to do is format our URL so that we include what's known as the query parameters that specify the currencies that we want to do the conversion for. So essentially, you may have seen before in URLs, if I go up here, that they have this question mark. And then after the question mark, you might see some variables that say like search is equal to, and then there's some text or something. These are known as query parameters, and you can pass them alongside the URL and the root. The root is the thing that comes after the slash here, and they specify what you want to get from the URL. Now, in our case, I just know what these are because I read the documentation. You don't need to read it. I'm going to share with you how it works. But what we're going to do is say that our URL is equal to an fstring. We're going to inject inside of here the base URL, and then we are going to put a question mark like this. And sorry, we don't need the question mark because it's already here. We're going to put an and sign like this because we're going to have more than one query parameter. And we're going to say the base underscore currency is equal to the base, which will be passed into this function as a parameter. And we're going to say and the currencies are equal to, and inside of here, we're going to specify the currencies that we want to convert to. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to make a variable called currencies. And inside of here, we're going to put the ticker symbol of the currencies we're interested in. In this case, I want USD, Canadian dollar, euro, the Australian dollar, and we'll go with CNY as well. I actually forget what currency that is. I'm sure many of you will roast me in the comments, but anyways, just want to show you we can do a bunch of different currencies. Okay, so these are the five currencies that I'm interested in converting to. And for the base, we can use anything that we want. It could be even one of these currencies. Regardless, what I'll do is I'll go and currencies is equal to, and then I'm going to put currencies in here. But the thing is, the way that the currencies are supposed to be passed in here is they're supposed to be separated by commas. So I'm going to show you a little trick that will take this list and convert it to a string that has comma separated values. The way we can do this is we can say our currencies in lowercase, as this is a variable, are equal to, and this will be a string with a comma, dot join, and then currencies. Now the way the dot join works is it takes all of the elements from a list and it will combine them together in a string using whatever the string is that you have here as the delimiter. The delimiter is just the separator. It's what goes in between these different values. So now what we'll end up getting is just a big string that has USD, comma CAD, comma euro, etc., which is what this query parameter is expecting the result to look like. So now I can pass inside of here currencies. So now we have the URL, and what's interesting is it's that if we just went to this URL in our browser, it would actually give us the result. But we don't want it in our browser, we want it here in our code. So what we're going to do is write a try catch block or a try accept block in Python, because it's possible an error could occur here. And we'll kind of talk about how that works in 1 second. And inside of this try block, we're going to send a request using our newly formatted URL to get some data. So to do that, Let's just make this smaller. First of all, we're going to say our response is equal to requests, which is what we have up here, right? Dot get. And we're simply going to get the URL that we just created. Again, remember, this is a combination of the base URL, which has our API key, as well as the query parameters, which are specifying the data we want. Now, whenever you send a request, you get a response. So that's why I'm calling this response. And then this response is going to contain something known as JSON. JSON is JavaScript object notation. You don't have to worry too much about that. What that really means in Python, though, is that we're actually going to get a dictionary back that will contain some key value pairs with the data that this API returned. So we're going to say the data is equal to the response.json. And for right now, we're simply going to print the data, and then we're going to return it like that. Now, inside of this accept block, I'm just going to show you how we could handle a potential error. I'm going to say that we will accept any exception as E, and we will print E like this and simply return none. Okay, so let's quickly break down this function. We break apart our currencies into the correct string that we're expecting here. We format our URL. We have a try except. Now, all this does is attempt to run all of this code. If something happens in this code and an error occurs, we simply go into this accept block rather than crashing the program. In the accept block, we say we're going to accept a general exception as E. That essentially means we're going to listen for any general exception that occurs. We're going to store that in the variable E, and then we can just print out E so we can actually see what the error was. Then we're simply returning none. Now, we can just quickly try this out to see if it works. So we can go convert currency, which is the name of our function, and we can just pass a string with the currency we want to convert. So I'm just going to go with Canadian dollars. Now, what I can do is say Python currency.py. Remember, on Mac or Linux, Python 3. And when I run this, notice that we get some data. So it actually returns to us a Python dictionary that says data. So that's the first key. And then we have a whole other Python dictionary that contains all of the different currencies based on, in our case, the Canadian dollar. Awesome. So now what we want to do is just make this a little bit more automated so the user can type it in rather than us passing it into this function. And we want to print this out so it looks a little bit nicer. So first things first, we want to access this interior dictionary, which means we want to use the key data on our data. So we're going to return data at data like this. And let's just quickly run this now. And notice that what's happening here. Oh, sorry, it's because I printed data. But what I'm going to do now is say data is equal to this and print data. And we're going to remove the print statement from up here. I know I'm going a bit fast, but I'm just trying to illustrate this to you. And you'll see now that we just get this interior dictionary. So the point of me doing that is that I don't want to have the key data. I just want to have all of my different exchange rates, which I'm getting here. Okay, so now we have that stored inside this variable. Now what we'll do is we'll just write something that will just print out all of these in a kind of nice orderly fashion so it's really easy for us to see. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, we can just write a for loop, and we can say for the ticker, comma, the value in our data.items. Now, since the data here is going to be a dictionary, this allows us to use this .items function, and the .items function will let us iterate over the dictionary and grab both the key value and the value, as we iterate over it. Not really sure how to explain that better, but items will give you essentially a list that contains first the ticker and then this value. So when you do for ticker comma value, you'll get both of them, and then you can just print them out. So I'm just going to say print, and we'll just print the ticker. So actually, we'll do it like this. We'll print an F string. We'll print inside of here the ticker, colon, and then we will print the value like that. Okay, so now if we clear and run, you see that we get all of our values popping up here. Okay, so Australian dollars this, Canadian one, CNY, Euro, USD, etc. Okay, so this is really good. The only thing that's a bit weird is that it's showing Canadian dollar one. I don't actually want to show that because I know what the base currency was that I'm converting from. So what I can do if I want to get rid of this is I can simply just write this. I can say delete data at Canadian dollar. So that means, okay, after we get our dictionary back that contains all of the values, we'll just delete the Canadian dollar key so we no longer have it. So now if I save and run, you see we just get the currencies that we want the conversion value for. Perfect. Now let's just make this code a little bit better, because right now I'm manually plugging in CAD. I don't want to manually put it in. I want to ask the user to tell me what currency they want to convert to. So what we'll do is start with that, and we'll say the base is equal to input. Input is how you get user input in Python. And we'll just say enter the base currency. And I'm going to say Q for quit. And this will just be something they can type in if they want to quit the program. Now, what I'm going to do is just convert their currency to uppercase. So whatever they give us, whatever they type in here, we'll convert it to uppercase just so that we always have everything in uppercase rather than getting some lowercase values. And then we will say, first of all, if the base is not in the currencies, so if it's not inside of the currencies that we have right here, then we can simply tell them that they had an invalid currency. Now, we don't have to do this, but there is some currencies that you can't use inside of the API. So we might actually run into some errors here. Although now that I think about it, I think it's probably fine actually if we remove that line. Yeah, I don't think we actually need to use that right now. Okay, anyways, we have the base. So now what we can do is just change Canadian dollar to be the base. So really quick fix there. And now if we come and run our code, it asks us, what do you want the base to be? So I can go with maybe AUD. And now it gives me all of the currencies other than Australian dollar, but it gives me the conversion rates from Australian dollar. Perfect. So this is really, really good. Last thing we want to do is just put this in a loop so that we can continue doing this as much as we want. So I can say while true. Oops, that's not what I meant to do. We'll get all of this. And all we're going to do right now after they enter something is we're going to check if they entered Q, because Q is how you can quit the program. So we're going to say if base is equal to Q, and notice that I'm doing an uppercase Q because we converted the input to uppercase, then I'm simply going to break, and breaking will just break out of the while loop. So that means we won't actually do the rest of this. Awesome. Last thing to check here, we're just going to say if not data. Now, what that actually means is if the data value that's returned to us is none, so if it doesn't have a value, then we can simply continue. The reason we're going to do that is because if we try to delete something from data, but data doesn't exist, that's going to crash our program and give us an error. So I'm just checking and saying, okay, well, it's possible we ran into an error here in our currency conversion function. If we did, we're going to return none. So if we have none here, we'll just continue rather than trying to do this, because this would actually cause some errors for us. And I can show you what I mean by that. So let's run the code and let's enter Canadian dollar again, like that. Okay, gives us all the values, and we can enter another base currency. Now, if I enter something like hello, notice it actually just gives us an error here and it says data. Now, the reason for that is that in the response, there was no key data. So it just kind of printed this out. Now, if we didn't want to print this weird message, we could just print this and we could say invalid currency like that. We don't even need this anymore. We could get rid of that. And this way you wouldn't get kind of that weird error message. So now if I quit the program by doing Q and I rerun this and I do hello, it just says invalid currency, and then we can go again. So now I can do again my AUD and it gives me all of my exchange rates. There you go. Okay, so let's quit that. And that is the first project. Now, all of this code will be available from the link in the description if you'd like to copy it. And obviously I will delete my API key so that you guys cannot abuse it. Last thing to mention here, if you wanted to actually convert a dollar amount, so maybe $100, $200, whatever, all you do is the exact same thing we currently have, except you would take whatever the rate is that you wanted to convert to, and you just multiply it by whatever the value is that you wanted the conversion from. So we have all the rates, just take the rate and multiply it by whatever the number is, and that gets your converted value. Okay, that is project one. Let's move on to project number two. Welcome to project number two. For this project, we're going to build a YouTube video downloader. Now, the way this will work is you will just type in a URL of a video you want to download. You will then open up the browse window. So you'll kind of select the location you want to save it to, and then it will just be downloaded. Very nice. So let's create a new file here. I'll just call this youtube.py. And similarly to the last project, we are going to install a module here that will make our life easier. So we're going to go here and say pip install PyTube. Same thing as before. You're going to want to change this to pip3 depending on your operating system. Okay, so let's install PyTube. You can see I've already got it installed. All right, so now that that's installed, we're going to do a few imports here. We're going to say from PyTube, import YouTube. You can guess why we need that. We're then going to say import tkinter. This is built into Python, by the way, as tk. And we're going to say from tkinter, import the file dialog like that. Now you'll see why we need this in a second, but tkinter is a very basic 2D graphics library, or kind of like GUI utility library in Python that lets you build some graphical user interfaces. We're simply going to use it just to have a directory pop-up so you actually get like a visual kind of place where you can select where you want the file to be saved. You'll see what I mean in a second, but you can do some more cool stuff with it. So if you're interested, you could check out tkinter. Pretty simple to get started with. Anyways, first thing we want to do is figure out how to download a YouTube video. So we're going to make a function here, which is download video. And what we need to download a video is the URL and the path that we want to save the file to. Now, similarly to before, we're going to do a try and accept block because stuff can always go wrong when you're using these kind of APIs. So we're going to say accept exception as E, and then we're going to say print E here. And inside the try block, we're going to start writing the code that we need to actually download the video. Now we're going to say YT, standing for YouTube, is equal to YouTube, and we are going to pass in the URL. Now what this will do is grab kind of an instance of the YouTube video based on the YouTube URL that we pass, and then we can kind of do a few things with it. Like we could get some stats about it, but in our case, we actually just want to download it. Now to download it, there's a few ways to go about doing this, but we want to download the highest resolution version. So the first thing we're going to do is get access to all of the different streams of this video. So we're going to say yt.streams.filter. We're going to say progressive is equal to true. And we're going to say the file underscore extension. Is that how you spell extension? I think it is. Is equal to MP4. Now you could change this if you want, but I think MP4 is just the default that most of us are going to use. Okay. Now that we have access to all of the different streams, so this is all the places we could be downloading it from, we're going to get the highest resolution stream. So we're going to say highest res stream is equal to streams.get underscore highest underscore resolution, like that. Now this is going to give us access to that stream. Now that we have access to that stream, we're going to download the video. So we're going to say highest res stream.download. We're just going to say the output underscore path is equal to the save path, which is the parameter passed into here. That's it. We can then go and say print video downloaded successfully exclamation point. Okay, pretty straightforward, but we can go ahead and test this out. So we can just say URL is equal to, and we'll grab a YouTube video URL. And then for the save path, we want to specify where we want to save it. Now, if we don't pass anything, it will just save it in the current directory where we currently are. But I'll show you again in a second how we can kind of fix the path a little bit so that it's a bit easier to figure out where we want to save it. Now, in my case, I'll just manually type in the path. So I'm going to say C drive colon forward slash users slash Tim slash desktop slash Python automation, which is the name of the folder that we are currently in. Okay, now we can call the function. So download video, URL, and save path. And now what we need to do is just get a YouTube video URL. Let me just grab one of my videos and I'll be right back. All right, so I just loaded up one of my YouTube videos, three types of projects that make you a programmer. But I couldn't help but notice, look at this link here, enroll in my free software development introduction course. That looks interesting. Let's click on that. And you can see that we have start your career in software development. And there's actually a free intro course you guys can take if you want that teaches you about how to break into software development if you are looking to actually land a job. Not going to shill this too hard. Obviously, there is a paid course here as well, but there is a completely free one that gives you a ton of value. It is 1 hour long. If you guys want to check it out, do that from the link in the description. Anyways, we have our link. Let's copy the link and paste that inside of the URL variable. And now, let's save and let's run our code. So Python youtube.py, give this a second to download. Okay. And you can see now that we get the three types of projects that make you a programmer, video downloaded successfully. And I'd be able to open that up now and actually watch it if I wanted to. Pretty straightforward. So now similarly to before, what we want to do is make this code a little bit better just so that we don't have to manually type in this path and we don't have to manually type in the URL. So let's scrap all this. And let's now write something that makes it a little bit more user-friendly. So what we're going to do is make a function here called open file dialog. This is going to open the file dialog, which will kind of pick where we're going to save the folder or the file. First though, we're going to say root is equal to tk.tk. Now, what this does is just instantiate the TK module and kind of creates a TK window, Tkinter window, right? To be able to use this file dialog, you need a window, but the thing is, it doesn't have to be shown. So what I can do is I can say root.withdraw. Now, what that will do is it will just hide the window so you don't see it kind of appearing on the screen. So we initialize the window, hide the window, and now we're actually able to use this root variable here, or really any tkinter type stuff, to be able to open the file dialog. So what I'm going to do inside of this directory is say folder is equal to the file dialog. Okay, and this is going to be ask directory. And then I'm going to say if the folder path. So if they actually type something in, then we're going to say print the F string selected folder. And I'm just going to print out what the folder was that they selected. And then I'm going to return the folder here. Okay, great. So now I'm going to go down and I'm just going to make one single line here. I'm going to say if underscore underscore name is equal to underscore underscore main underscore underscore. Now you might be asking, what the heck is this crazy line that I'm looking at, Tim? Well, what this line will do is make sure that you are directly running this Python file before it executes anything that happens under this. That's it. All that means is that if you run this code directly, this will run. If you don't, it won't. The reason you would ever even need this is because sometimes you'll have some code inside of here that might be reused by another file. So for example, maybe our currency.py file uses something inside of here. If we don't have this line and currency were to import this module, that would actually run all of the code. Like it would run all this stuff here. So actually with that in mind, let's put this here so that anything we do is only going to happen if we directly run this Python file. I'm hoping that makes a bit of sense, but you guys can ask ChatGPT or look it up if you want some more clarification. Pretty standard Python syntax. Anyways, we're going to say the video URL is equal to input. And we're going to say, please enter a URL. And this is going to be a YouTube URL. And notice I just added a space here. The reason for that is this input doesn't automatically put a space after it. So I just put a space so that we'll get some separation with the colon. Okay, so we're going to get the video URL. We're then going to get the save directory. So I'm going to say save dir is equal to the open file dialog. And I'm just going to quickly do something here. I'm going to say if not folder like this, and I'm going to say print, please select folder dot, dot, dot. We got to change this to say save directory. And then I'm going to type continue, like actually not continue. Yes, please select the dir. Okay. And then I'm going to put an else here and I'm going to say download video, video URL and save directory. And actually, rather than please select a folder, I'm going to say invalid save location. Okay. So what did I just do here? I wrote a very simple line that simply asks for some input. So it's going to get the video URL. I then had this save directory. So we're going to open the file dialog. You're going to see how that works in 1 second. I'm just going to make sure that they actually did select a folder because it's possible they could just exit out of it. If they did, so which is actually in the else statement here, I'm going to download the video. If they didn't, which is what this is checking, I'm going to print they have an invalid save location. Now, if we want this to be a bit more clear, we could actually swap these around and say if they have a save directory, then we'll download the video. Otherwise, we'll do this. And if we want, we could do a little print statement here and say print started download, just in case the download takes a while or you have slow internet, so people know something is actually happening. Yeah, zoom out a bit so we can read more of the code at once. Again, all of this will be available from the description. And let's give this a test. Python youtube.py, enter a URL. Okay, that's not the URL that I wanted. Let's go back here and grab my URL, paste that in. Okay, then notice it brings up a location. So I could go desktop and what was this? Python automation. Okay, now it's actually gonna, this isn't gonna be good because it's gonna save in the same thing. Okay, let's just save it to my downloads. I'm going to select downloads as the folder. Notice it says started download. Okay, we'll give this a second and then it should be downloaded inside of my downloads. So if I go to my downloads, cd dot dot, cd dot dot, cd downloads, ls, you can see that we have three types of projects that make you a programmer and it's been downloaded. Okay, so that was it for project number 2. Hope you enjoyed. Let's move on to the last project. Moving on to our last project, we are going to write some code that will do an automatic folder backup for us. This is actually pretty simple, but I just wanted to show it to you because it is kind of a realistic and real-world project. Anyways, what we need to start by doing is installing a Python module just like before. So we're going to say pip install, and we're going to install the schedule module. You could probably guess what this is going to do, but it is going to help us schedule a kind of task to run. Now, this will show you how to schedule really any task. It doesn't have to be a folder backup. We're going to make a new Python file here. I'm just going to call this backup.py. And inside of here, we're going to import a few things that we need. So we're going to import OS, which stands for operating system. We're going to import shoutil, or however you pronounce this, which will do some copying operations for us. We're going to import date time, because when I back up a folder, I actually want to save the new folder as the date that this was backed up, so we can kind of have a history of all our backups. I'm then going to import the schedule module, and I'm going to import the time module. Okay, we've got our imports. Now, what we need to do is specify what the source directory is, so the thing that we want to back up, and what the destination directory is. So what I'm going to do is say my source dir is equal to, and I'm just going to manually type in the path for this that I want it to be. So I'm going to do /users/tim/pictures/screenshots. Now you can do any folder that you want. You just have to find the path to it. Now, if you're wondering, how do I find the path to it? Well, there's a few ways you can do this. Now I have to show you on Windows, because I'm obviously on Windows. But if I open up my file explorer here and I go to my, if I can do this, pictures and screenshots, what I can do is just click in the address bar here and it just gives me the path, okay? So that's how you would do this on something like Windows. Now on Mac, you should be able to just open up a folder. So you should be able to like right click on it and go to the properties of that folder or get more info about the folder. And it should show you the path to where that folder is. So that's how you can pick the location. Although I'm sure you guys can probably figure out how to find the path. Now we also need to have the destination directory. So I'm going to say destination dir is going to be equal to, and then here, what I'm going to do is C:\users/tim/desktop/backups. Now I just made a new folder on my desktop called backups. You can put the folder wherever you want, but obviously just make sure the folder exists that you're going to be backing up into. Okay. So now we have the source directory and the destination directory. We're going to make our function. So we're going to say copy folder to directory, and inside of here we're going to take in our source and our destination, and we're going to say first of all today is equal to date time dot date dot today. Now what that's going to do is simply give us the current day today. That's all this does, okay? Just gives us the date today based on our computer. We're then going to say the destination directory is going to be equal to os.path.join, and we're going to take in our destination, which is passed here, and we're going to combine this with the string of today's date. Now the reason I'm doing this is that we're essentially going to have this backups directory, okay? And inside of here we're going to have a bunch of folders. All these folders will be our backup, and those folders will be labeled like 11, you know, 23 2023, right, which is the current date. So what I'm doing is I'm getting the current date, and I am combining the current date with my destination directory so that inside of this directory, I have a new directory, which contains the backup, which is named today's date. Okay. Now, similarly to before, we're going to do a try. We're going to say shoutil.copyTree. Now, copyTree just copies everything recursively, which means anything inside of the folder, it will copy. And we're going to copy from our source to our destination directory, okay? Make sure you don't use dest, use destination directory, because that's the new directory we just set up. Awesome. Then we'll do a little print statement here. We can do an F string. We could say folder copied to the destination directory. And then we can do accept exception as E. And actually, I'm going to do something different because I'll show you how this works. I'm going to accept the file exists error, and I'm going to print an F string and say folder already exists in the destination. Now what this is doing is essentially saying, okay, it's possible that an error occurs here when I try to copy my source directory to my destination directory. If that's the case, that means there's actually already a directory with the same name inside of this, base destination directory. So we are just going to catch that error so that our program doesn't crash. And we are going to handle that by just printing out, hey, this is the error that occurred. Okay, we're almost done. So first of all, right now, if I want, I can just do this. So copy folder directory, and I can pass my source directory and my destination directory. Now let's just open that up. So if we go here and we go to desktop, you can see I have backups. Nothing's inside of here, okay? Now if I go ahead and run my code, python backup.py, we'll see if we get an error or not. It says folder copied here, okay? So if I open this up now, you can see we have screenshots appearing. Now the name is a little bit glitched. Don't worry, this actually will be named the correct thing. For some reason, whenever you copy a Windows created folder, which is the one that I did, it kind of glitches in the IDE. So you can see date created actually shows the correct name here, right? But it's just appearing as screenshots because there's some kind of weird caching issue in Windows Explorer. So it does actually have the correct name. Just trust me, I was messing with this before too. For some reason, it has like this weird kind of caching thing. If you were to like restart the computer, you should see the correct name. Anyways, not a huge deal. I'm sure for you guys that worked because I got it working before. But now what we want to do is we want to schedule this to run every single day at a certain time, right? Because we want to back up consistently. So what we can do is the following. We can say schedule.every.day.at, and we can specify a time in 24-hour time code that we want to do this backup at. Now for me right now, it's about 6:52. So I'm going to just put this to 6:55 right now. We can change that in a second. And I'm going to do .do, and I just put the name of the function that I want to run whenever this schedule occurs. So what we've done now is we've scheduled this task, which is just a function, right? So notice I didn't call the function. I just put the name of the function. And what this will do here is call the function on my behalf. Now, what we're going to see is that there's a little bit of an issue because we have our source and we have our destination, which are parameters that we need to pass to this function. So what we can actually do is write kind of a fancy line of Python code, which if you made it this far, I will treat you with, which is something known as a lambda. Now, I'm going to say lambda, and inside of here, I'm going to put my source dir, and I'm going to put my destination dir. Now, what I've done is I've essentially written what's known as an inline or anonymous function. So the idea is this dot do takes a function that it needs to call. The problem is we need to pass some parameters to that function. There's a few other ways to do this, but one way to do this is, okay, we're actually going to write the call to the function with the parameters that we need. But we don't want to call the function. We got to pass a function to this argument. So what we do is we write a lambda, and now what this does is it actually wraps a function. So it says, okay, lambda is a function that's going to call this. So now we're saying, okay, well, we have a function inside of here. So when we have dot do, we call this lambda function, which then goes ahead and does this. I know it seems weird, but it's the same thing as doing this, define L, and then inside of here you put this. Okay, so let's copy this and paste that here. And then rather than writing the lambda, we just put L, which is the name of our function. Okay, this is the exact same thing. So the function does this, which just calls this. Rather than doing this, we use this lambda, which is this kind of inline anonymous function. A bit more of advanced Python syntax, but hopefully you found it cool. Okay, last thing we need to do. We're going to say while true, like this, and we're going to say schedule.run_pending, and then we're just going to say time.sleep, 60 seconds. Now, let's just move this down a bit, and I'll explain. So what we're doing is we're scheduling a task to run every day at 6:55. However, the way this schedule works is that it's not actually going to execute the task for us until we have this schedule.run_pending call. So what we're doing is inside of a while loop, which means just infinitely, we are going to consistently run this run pending command, which will look for any scheduled tasks that have been scheduled that haven't yet ran, and it will run them for us. We're then going to sleep for 60 seconds or 1 minute so we don't just constantly keep calling this, but every 1 minute we're going to check, because this will go up every minute, right? If the task needs to be ran, and if it needs to be ran, we'll run it. If it doesn't, well, nothing will run. So technically, you could just leave this Python file running forever in the background on your computer, and every day at whatever time you put, it's going to update your code. Obviously, if you turn off the computer, you need to rerun the Python file, but this is how you schedule a task to run at a certain increment. Now, you can also do every week, every year, every minute, every second, like any increment you want, pretty much, you can set and you can schedule a task. So in our case, we did every day, but you can do any increment you want. Now, I need to make the time a bit further because it took longer to explain, and we can test this. So I'm going to say Python and backup.py. Currently, it is, issue, invalid time format for a daily job. Okay, I think we need to do, it's because I have 657. It would need to be 0657. But what I actually want to put is the 24-hour time code, which is 1857. So now if I run this, it's good. It's just because I didn't have four digits for my time code. So actually a good error to run into there. We want four digits. Now it's 56 p.m., not 56 a.m. Sorry, so that's why I had that issue. Anyways, I'm just going to wait 1 minute here, and we should see that it will automatically actually do the backup for us. Let's give this a second, and I'll be right back. All right, so it actually worked. It says folder already exists because the folder is already in that location that we're trying to do. Anyways, though, it did automatically run this task as soon as it hit 6:57. Now, we could just continue to let this run, and tomorrow, at the exact same time, it would then go ahead and run this backup task. Okay, so I'm going to close this by hitting Control-C. That's how you can actually quit this program when you have it running. And there you go. That will finish this video. So I hope you guys enjoyed. If you did, make sure you leave a like, subscribe to the channel. Obviously, all of this code will be available from the link in the description. And don't forget to sign up for my free Introduction to Software Developing course.